Good afternoon. Welcome to the second event of the Understanding India series organized by Paraspar. Paraspar, as some of you might know, is an initiative by the Office of Communication, Indian Institute of Science, where we try to initiate and generate discussions on various knowledge systems. We have had many interesting lectures in this series, but this is probably one of the more interesting events among all, where we try and understand the country, our own country, through the lenses of cricket. And for the panel discussion today, we have two people who are probably the best people we could have had for this topic. And they need no introduction, but just for the sake of custom, I'm continuing the custom of introduction. I will give you a brief introduction. Professor Ramchandra Guha is a historian and an author. Among his many books includes A Pioneering Environmental History, The Unquiet Wood, A Landmark History of Republic India After Gandhi, and an authoritative two-volume biography of Mahatma Gandhi, both of which were chosen by the New York Times as a notable book of the year. He has taught at Yale, Stanford, and at our very own Indian Institute of Science. He is currently distinguished professor at Kriya University. Professor Guha has been a professional historian for 3 decades now, and along with being a cricket enthusiast. He says he writes on history for a living and on cricket to live. His award include the Leopold Hiddy Prize of the American Society of Environmental History, the Daily Telegraph Cricket Society Prize, the R.K. Narayanan Prize, and the Fukuoka Prize. He is a recipient of an honorary doctorate from Yale University. And our second panelist for today is Sharda Ugra, who is most loved sports journalist and writer of the country. She has spent more than 3 decades in sports journalism, working with Mumbai Tabloid Midday, The Hindu, India Today magazine, and ESPN Cricket Info and ESPN India. During this time, she has written and spoken about issues around Indian sport at home and abroad in popular and academic publications. She has worked with former New Zealand captain John Wright on John Wright's Indian Summer, his memoirs of his years coaching India, and with Yuvraj Singh on The Test of My Life, an account of his diagnosis and recovery from cancer. She was a fellow of the Australian India Institute, University of Melbourne in 2013. Having just left a formal workplace, we believe, and along with her, that she is just getting started. So the format would be that each panelist speaks for around 15-20 minutes, then they have a discussion, and after that we will open up for questions. The questions, you can raise your hand or you can type in the questions in the chat box. I'll read out questions for you. So we'll start with Professor Ramchandra Guha.
Thank you, Bitashta. Thank you, Sharda. Thank you all for being here. So I'm going to ask and seek to answer 3 questions in my talk. First, why did cricket take root in India and become so popular? Second, how has the support for cricket as a sport and as a passion deepened and expanded in recent decades? And finally, a more complex and difficult question, does the sport of cricket as played and practiced in India sometimes reflect the uglier sides of Indian society? So let me begin with the first question. Why did cricket take root in India? Because it's a foreign sport. It's not an indigenous game, unlike kabaddi or polo or chess. It came from outside and it came with the colonizers. It came with an alien, hostile and conquering people. When India became independent in 1947, independent of British rule, there was a series of strident demands for cricket to quit India with the British. In fact, "Will Cricket Quit India with the British?" was the title of an article written by the prominent Congress leader B.V. Keskar, who was Minister for Information and Broadcasting in Jawaharlal Nehru's first cabinet. And it was published in the progressive left-wing weekly Blitz in 1946. But it was clear that the British was leaving, and Keskar published his article saying, when the British leave, cricket should leave with them. And I'm going to give you some choice quotations of that article, because they read rather oddly today when we are so absolutely crazily obsessed with the sport of cricket in India. Keskar said in this article, "Cricket is a game purely English in culture and spirit. It's a part of the English countryside with its peculiar climate and social customs. It is like fox hunting and fishing. He went on to say that in England, where cricket originated, cricket was a sport of the gentry and the nobility. And in India, similarly, it's an upper caste sport. It is, to quote Keskar, a game patronized mostly by the Maharajas, the rich, and the snobs. Its existence in India, argued this fervent Congress nationalist B.B. Keskar, was but a sign of our utter slavery. Our tendency to copy blindly the habits of English civilization and ape the likes and preferences of the English gentleman. So said Keskar, cricket in India has thrived in the atmosphere of English culture, English language, and English rule, but cricket, he went on, will never be able to survive the shock of the disappearance of British rule from our country. With the fall of British power, cricket is bound to lose its place of honor and slowly grow out of date. Now, this is a mainstream Congress nationalist, a member of Jawaharlal Nehru's first cabinet, telling us that cricket has no place in India. And he was not alone. To the left of Keskar was the radical socialist Ram Manohar Lohia, who likewise detested cricket. To the right of Keskar was the RSS leader M.S. Golwalkar. Now, Golwalkar and Lohia had three pet obsessions, which in no particular order were Jawaharlal Nehru, the English language, and the game of cricket. And they often polemicized against cricket, seeing it like as a sign of slavery, of certitude, of not being able to decolonize our mind. And to become truly Indian, truly Swadeshi, we had to play Indian sports. Now, so you had mainstream Congress nationalists saying in 1947 that cricket must quit India. You had radical socialists saying the same thing. You had indigenous Hindu nationalists arguing along similar lines, but cricket has flourished nonetheless. So that's my first question. Why has cricket taken root in India? And I'm going to offer you just really four reasons. There may be others, but four reasons why I feel cricket has become such an incredibly popular sport in India. First of all, it's the techniques of the game, the elements of the sport are very easy to learn in our cities, which are crowded with not many open spaces, with not, you know, where until very recently, you didn't even have well-maintained cricket fields with turf pitches and so on. But in a gully, in a courtyard, in an apartment complex, if you have a piece of wood and a ball, you can learn the essential techniques of the game, how to bowl straight, how to turn the ball, how to play on the side. Whereas for football, to learn the elements of football, you would need space on all sides. To learn the elements of tennis, you would need a decent racket and a well-maintained court. So the morphology of Indian cities, the way they are laid out, the way people live collaboratively, collectively, the lack of open spaces do not really encourage other sports, but cricket, whatever, if it's 22 yards, even 15 yards, you can learn cricket. So I think that's the first reason. The second reason I think Indians have taken to cricket is that you don't have to be particularly fit physically. We know today that, you know, Virat Kohli spends a hell of a lot of time in the gym. But if you look at the Indian cricketers of the past, they were not really specimens of athleticism or of robust, you know, physical stature. I mean, take India's great off-spinner Erappally Pasanda, a boyhood hero of mine. I mean, he looked really like an overfed businessman. But he had the art which his fingers could give him to become such a great spin bowler. So unlike other sports like athletics, like tennis, like football, like hockey, physical strength is not really mandatory to becoming excelling in cricket. It is just dexterity of hands and wrists and, of course, of your mind. The third reason cricket has taken root in India, I think this is a very, very important reason, underappreciated, is that the action in the game is interrupted. In football, it's continuous. In tennis, it's continuous, hitting back and forth. In cricket, it's interrupted and episodic. You bowl a ball, then the bowler goes back. Then you, after the over, end of an over, you change. A wicket falls, there's a 2-minute hiatus. There's a drinks break. There's a lunch break. There's a tea break. There's an overnight break before play resumes the next morning. And what this means, what the interrupted episodic nature of the game means, is that spectators can participate, can interrogate players, can talk to one another. And in that respect, cricket spectatorship indulges the participatory, sociable nature of Indian culture and society in a much more emphatic way, in a much more thoroughgoing way than watching a sport where the action is fast-paced and interrupted. You can continue your friendship, you can indulge your love of gossip while watching a cricket match, which you can't while watching a tennis match or a football match. And finally, I think the reason cricket has taken sport so root in India is that really it's the only sport at which Indians are any good. Certainly the only Indian team sport. We are, you know, football is rightly the world's greatest and most popular game, but we haven't been in an Olympics since 1956. Once upon a time, we used to be quite good at hockey, but now we are probably 8th or 10th or 12th best team in the world. So it's the only team sport at which we had a reasonably good track record, and that, of course, cultivates the patriotic sentiment that Indians have and why they follow cricket so intensely. So that's the first question I wanted to lay before you to try and explain despite vehement opposition by nationalists who saw this as a British imposition on India, who saw Indians playing cricket as a sign of slavery, of not having shaken off the colonial yoke, why, despite this proselytizing against cricket by radicals of left and right, cricket has survived and flourished in India. And now coming to my second question, which I'll seek to answer, about trying to explain the massive expansion in cricket's popularity in recent decades. And in explaining this expansion in cricket's popularity, let me be somewhat autobiographical. In the 1970s, when I was a school and college student, I followed cricket very intensely, but I also followed other sports. I watched, in my years as a student in Delhi University, I watched many Davis Cup matches. Vijay Hamritraj was a hero of mine, just as Sunil Gavaskar was a hero of mine. I watched hockey. I followed the 1975 World Cup, which we won minute by minute on the radio. And in my pantheon of sporting heroes, Ajit Pal Singh was up there with Kapil Dev. But over the years, I became a one-sport person. All I watched was cricket, hockey, tennis, football, badminton, all of which I watched eagerly as a young boy fell by the wayside. And as I was becoming a one-sport human being, India itself was becoming a one-sport nation. Cricket was, I mean, the Indian sporting fan generically really had room only for one game, and that was cricket. And in this shrinking of the Indian sporting imagination, this elevation, massive elevation of cricket above all other sports, two concurrent events played a very important role. In 1982, the Asian Games were held in Delhi, and in the hockey final, India was pitted against Pakistan. Technically, India is still, I beg your pardon, technically, hockey is still India's quote unquote national sport. And in 1980, we were pretty good at it. 1982, we had just won the Olympics in Moscow in 1980. But in this Asian Games final in Delhi in 1982, we lost 7-1 and to none other than Pakistan. So there was humiliation on the hockey field, followed less than a year later by India's totally unexpected but absolutely thrilling victory in the Cricket World Cup in England. And this simultaneous dethroning of hockey and elevating of cricket was to rapidly accelerate from then onwards, and satellite television played a very important role. Till the late 1970s, there was no live television in India. You could not even watch the test match in the city in which it was played. after the World Cup victory, there were satellite television came in everywhere. In 1985, we played the World Championship of Cricket Down Under, which we again won, giving cricket a further boost. And we watched every ball of that tournament, which we would not have been able to do 2 or 3 years previously. And from then onwards, cricket's popularity and appeal dramatically expanded all over India. Since the 1980s, cricket has expanded its reach and its scope in India, both geographically as well as socially. I underline. Both geographically as well as socially. Geographically, cricket has expanded its reach, or indeed its tentacles, from metros to small towns and even to villages. And this is, of course, reflected most dramatically in the composition of the Indian cricket team. In 1971, when we won our first series in England, I think 7 out of 11 cricketers were from Bombay. This last winter, when we won a test match in Australia, I think 10 different Ranji Trophy teams were represented in the playing 11. I'm not sure, I forget now. One, maybe it was Tamil Nadu, which had 2 players, but everyone else only contributed to 1 team. So, whether it's playership or spectatorship, the appeal of cricket has expanded from the metros to the small towns and even villages. So there's been a geographical democratization of the game, and there's also been a social democratization of the game. Contrary to what B.E.B. Keskar claimed, that cricket in India is a game of the Maharaja, the rich and the snobs, every class of Indian, every caste of Indian, every religious denomination, equally every region of India watches, follows, discusses, debates cricket with equal passion and intensity. And one of the most remarkable features, aspects of the spread of cricket's popularity in my own lifetime is its breaching of the gender divide. When I was young and right into my 30s, very few Indian women followed cricket. Now, in many matches, you'd probably have 30% males. 70% male, 30% female, whereas when I was young, it would not even have been 3% female. And of course, it's not an accident that one consequence of cricket breaching the gender divide is that India's finest cricket journalist is a female, my fellow co-panelist on our discussion today. So, the extraordinary expansion of cricket's appeal from the 1980s awaits a proper historical scrutiny, but it's quite remarkable how it has expanded geographically and socially. Cricket today in 2021 is not just India's most popular sport, it is India's greatest popular passion. It's far greater as a popular passion than the Bollywood film. In the 1980s, Kapil Dev, who's sometimes called Indian cricket's first superstar, was far less popular than his contemporary, the film actor Amitabh Bachchan. By the 1990s, when Sachin Tendulkar replaced Kapil Dev as Indian cricket's acknowledged superstar, Tendulkar was, in terms of popular perception, in terms of brand endorsements, in terms of ubiquity of appearance in television commercials, on par with the greatest Bollywood star of his day, Shah Rukh Khan. So they were about equal. Today, Virat Kohli and before him, MS Dhoni, were far more popular than any Bollywood star. So it's quite, I mean, in my lifetime, I've seen first cricket spectacularly vanquish hockey as India's number one sport. And secondly, even more remarkably, because I'm a sociologist by training, cricket vanquish the Bollywood film as our greatest national passion. It consumes much more energy, emotion, debate, discussion, and money than the Bollywood film. And a sign of this is that when the IPL is played, no blockbuster films are released. And it's not just our film stars and our film directors that recognize cricket as India's greatest popular passion, so does our Prime Minister. Our Prime Minister normally gives his nationwide addresses at 8 p.m. But when IPL was on, he made sure he'd give his nationwide address at 6 p.m. before the IPL started, because he wanted as large an audience as would have been available to him. He wanted no competition, right? So I think that's the second question I wanted to just briefly discuss and seek to explain. How is it that cricket has become so incredibly popular that it has even exceeded the Bombay film in its appeal, in the excitement, the emotion, the intensity, and the money and eyeballs it attracts? I come finally to the senior side of cricket in Indian society. I mean, obviously, I love the game of cricket. I've written several books about it. But I still don't think that we should blindly celebrate its popularity. Its spread, its social, economic, psychological spread in India has an underside in at least three respects. First, the first underside of cricket's popularity is a distinct caste bias in representation in the Indian cricket team. In my book, A Corner of Foreign Field, I talk about the first great family of Indian cricketers who were four Dalit brothers, the Palwankar brothers. Ranji was not an Indian cricketer, he was an English cricketer. The first great Indian cricketer was a left-arm spinner from a Dalit background called Balwankar Balu. But the Indian cricket team today is dominated by upper caste Hindus. And I think that's something which is not adequately discussed or debated, but is a representation, is a reflection of the fact that there is a caste bias in how cricket representation, in who is chosen for the Indian cricket team. And there may be times in the past when there have been half a dozen Brahmins, you know, which is not because Brahmins are superior, but because they have certain social and cultural advantages that allow them to take to cricket as a profession much easier than people from working class or low caste backgrounds. The second seamy side to Indian cricket today is communalism is also present. From the 1960s onwards, if an Indian Muslim played for India and did badly, all kinds of nasty questions would be raised about his performance, especially if the match was against Pakistan. More recently, the tragic case of Wasim Jafar, one of our greatest Ranji Trophy cricketers who played with distinction for many years in India, was unfairly and accused of communalism while running the Uttarakhand state team, and not a single top cricketer except Anil Kumble stood up for him. So communalism and casteism and communalism are two general disfigurements or deficiencies in Indian society that find their way into the cricketing field as well. And so finally, that's corruption and cronyism. In the way in which the cricket board is run now by the Home Minister's son, whose only qualification for being secretary of the BCCI is that he's the Home Minister's son, in the way in which contracts are allotted, in the way in which IPL franchise were decided, in the senior side of betting and match fixing, corruption and cronyism is rampant in cricket administration. And finally, one of the darker aspects of the staggering growth in cricket's popularity in India is the not always beneficial association of cricket with jingoistic nationalism. And I've written about this in some detail in my recent book, The Commonwealth of Cricket. Now, if you want a stark illustration, way in which cricket can reflect all that is bad in our society, in Indian society today, consider only the new cricket stadium in Ahmedabad that is named after a sitting prime minister. Now, this is historic and epical because this kind of thing has never happened in a so-called democracy. You have sporting stadiums named after dictators in the past. Hitler, Mussolini, Stalin, Saddam Hussein, and now Narendra Modi. And if that was not bad or depressing enough, the two ends of the Narendra Modi Stadium in Ahmedabad are called the Adani end and the Abani end after the two most egregiously successful crony capitalist of 21st century India. So that's the last thought I wanted to leave you with, that cricket's extraordinary popularity has come at a cost. The game itself represents, illustrates, exemplifies, and sometimes intensifies some of the worst aspects of Indian society: casteism, communalism, corruption, and chamchagiri. Thank you very much, and I now look forward to Sharda's presentation.
Thank you so much, Professor Guha. Maybe now request Sharda Ubra to speak.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for being here, Ram. Thanks for those very kind words about me and those absolutely sweeping and almost vast range of sort of factoids and facts and history and society that you've just given us. I just want to take on from, I was most happy that you went straight into it without, you played all your shots. I've just come up as someone to just little clean up the innings towards the end, as they say. I read a very interesting piece today in the newspaper, the Indian Express, which was talking about the IPL, and that said that the cricket board is going to request the Indian government to allow separate IPL security check-ins at counters at the airport so that teams can have a secure bio bubble. Now, all this is happening because, of course, there is a huge, COVID cases, and everyone wants the IPL to go on. And therefore, they are having this thing. But you're saying the board is going to ask the government, which means that Amit Shah and Jay Shah are just going to have a conversation. That, is this going to happen? So that is where we are. When the topic of this discussion is unraveling India through cricket, and you're just wondering at this point, when all of you have listened to what Ram had to say, is that what's unraveling? Is cricket unraveling? Is India unraveling? Anyhow, so I think the last, say, 25 years or so that Indian cricket, that I've seen Indian cricket as a journalist, I've seen the changes that have taken place. And we have to understand that what has happened is that it has taken on an entity in the sport of enormous wealth, influence, and power. And Ram, just one more thing, in that Indian team in the Australia series, there were two people from Bombay, Ajinkya Rahane and Rohit Sharma. Being a Bombay wala myself, I felt I have to say this. I have to make the point across. Ram is a diehard Karnataka supporter, and I come from Bombay / Mumbai, so we Bombay walas have to stand up for our own. Anyhow, it's quite, in a way, to my mind, the way I looked at Indian cricket is almost that Indian cricket has reinvented what was seen by the nationalists at the time, this sport that was purely English in nature and spirit, and that it reflected culture, language, and English rule. Because what Indian cricket did was take it out of formal settings and put it on the street, which not just India, in the entire South Asia, that is how cricket is played. It is played without, it's not regimented, it's played in absolutely in places that you can't imagine. In England, for example, it's played in a ground, it's proper, there's a pitch, there are two side screens, there is tea after every match. And in India, cricket is played everywhere. There was, in the very early 90s, a photographer put together a book called, very long and unwieldy title, but a really interesting one. It said, it's an Into the Passionate Soul of Subcontinental Cricket. And it basically had photographs of how cricket was played on the streets, which you will find it only in this part of the world. You would think that in Australia, cricket would be exactly what it looked like on television to us, for my generation growing up, that it's all very casual and matey and everything, but it's not. It's very formalized. Whereas in India, it's structured, and it's in South Asia, it's structured and it's played all the year round, which is what helped its entire spread. The fact that it was easy to play, everyone knows the story of how Sunil Gavaskar learned how to play why his technique was so tight is because he was playing in a very between buildings, and if you hit the ball and you broke a boundary, you broke a window, you were out. So that's the kind of the change that Indian cricket has wrought, and what came from it were two turning points. At a time where I think Indian cricket began to reflect what was happening in the country was perhaps in the 1990s. The Babri Masjid had just fallen, And for the first few months after that, literally a couple of months, maybe March, February, you had the first time you had cable television come into India, and you had somebody else other than Doordarshan showing you what cricket could be. And the administrator at that time understood that the TV rights actually meant something to them. They meant value, they meant money, and that's how they were going to sell it. They were going to stand up to the government. And 1991 also marked liberalization. So you see these two parallel events taking place, and you see these almost arcs play themselves out in a way that in the 1990s, all the way up to the IPL, maybe about, say, 15 years or so, it was at India as we understood it, that India that stood for sort of almost like a subcontinental sort of a brotherhood around it in cricket, certainly, whatever it was politically, however India and Pakistan were having their various skirmishes going along. But certainly in cricket, there was a very strong Asian identity that was created. You know, that Jagmohan Dalmia, for whatever else his flaws may have been, he made sure that he looked after the Sri Lankans, the Pakistanis. The subcontinent has held three World Cups together. Many countries together. They were able to get India, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, and then it was India, Sri Lanka, and Bangladesh to have these events at a time when the 90s, this is 1987, 1996, and then 2011. In the 90s particularly, it's not that there was no fractious relationship. The relationship between India and Pakistan was very, very contested. But cricket was above that kind of bad blood around cricket. The cricket administrators and cricketers themselves, they were not part of the narrative that was being that began to turn around and produce itself after television. You know, they were completely separate from it, and they were almost like this block. I don't know whether all of you who are here, I mean, I'm seeing it's about 60 plus people. I don't know whether you remember of a time in 1996 that there was a bomb explosion at the central bank in Sri Lanka, and Australia and West Indies said, we are not going to play in the World Cup. Literally hours before the opening ceremony of the World Cup, or maybe it was just a couple of days after, my memory is not serving me correctly, a joint Indo-Pak team went and played in a match in support and solidarity of the Sri Lankans in Colombo. Like, they just flew over. Azharuddin was the captain. There were five Indians and six Pakistanis in that team. And because they didn't want to figure out what uniform to wear, they all wore whites, which is the original color of sort of test cricket, as all of us remember and love it and so on. And now if you look back at that time and you think that this kind of thing would not be possible, the India that has changed so much is that nor will this not be possible. You have to ask yourself, coming back to what Ram was talking about, communalization, you have to ask yourself, will a Muslim, a Christian or a Sikh captain India again? And to cricket fans, this will look like a really harsh and a very, like, you know, let's not talk about politics, but it is what it is. This is what we have seen play itself out here. So if Indian cricket was reflecting what was happening in India, it was in the 90s, it was able to be above the political sort of ructions that were being caused and exist on another level, that fans were able to engage with it and look at it differently, look at players differently. Even though Ram remembers being at the Chinnaswamy Stadium at Javed Miadad's last match, and there were people booing him and no one was clapping for him. And, you know, so that thing set in my mind. That was the time that marked the shift of the Indian cricket watcher as just being a cricket watcher and becoming this very, very almost in your face kind of a fan. That may perhaps just be the result of a sport which reaches this level of having to create tribes and to create camps and to create things of the sort. Maybe that's how it's a social anthropological study, maybe, to see how fandom changes when sports get more successful. You have to look at it. That is seen as the prime reason for success in, say, the tribal passions that are followed in European football. And maybe that is what it is. I mean, I'm not an academician, I'm not an expert in the subject, but I certainly see that a period marking the change. Then you move ahead, sort of 15 years ahead, from, say, about 10 years ahead, 12, when the IPL was formed. And it's almost like the IPL has become now the calling card of Indian cricket. It's become, Everyone talks about the IPL as being, you know, it is the lone Indian product, the lone Indian brand that we can be proud of. It is as if, you know, creating a pharmaceutical industry that supplies drugs to the global south is not something to be proud of. But you have to have a brand that creates money, glitz, glamour, bling, all the rest of it. That is the brand that everyone is proud of about, you know, India's soft power is the IPL, amongst other things. And at that point, what we have seen in Indian cricket is a move away from a sort of whatever you may say about how the Indians competed on the field, whatever you may say about Saurav Ganguly's captaincy not being like, say, Sachin Tendulkar's or Gavaskar's or Kapil Dev's, in a sort of way that he was again out, you know, waving his fist at various people and so on. It was a different tone to it as to what has happened now. Because the rise of nationalism and this sort of expression of jingoism, whether it is through the television broadcast medium, whether it is through how cricket is even presented to all of us, particularly bilateral nation versus nation cricket, this is reflected in what cricket has come to represent, Indian cricket has come to represent. What are we talking about all the time? New India, new India, new India. What is the government talking all the time about, or what are the cheerleaders talking about all the time? New India, Naveen Bharat, that whole kind of, you get into that whole sort of thing of new India. And you're seeing that the IPL, the most wonderful thing about the IPL is that India never loses in the IPL. Some Indian team is always winning, right? So that's why everyone is very, it's an easy sell in the sense. I mean, there are other parts of the IPL that we can talk about. I know Ram absolutely does not like it. Ram, have you changed your position on it? I don't.
No.
Yeah. No, stridently not change. Mine, sort of, I look at it anthropologically as another sport differently, and I sort of manage. But this whole thing of, you know, there's always going to be, India doesn't have to lose, so we're all very happy and we're very fine. And that whole arc that has happened where money has come in, what has it has meant is that India has then now switched over to becoming not the leader of the Asian bloc. The Indians used to be called the leader of the Asian bloc. Now we are seen as we are aligning ourselves where power is, where authority is. We align ourselves with England and Australia, who were the, you know, India used to be the anti-establishment country in cricket. Now we are the establishment in cricket. You know, India, I'm saying we as if I'm speaking for the BCCI, which I'm not, but I assume you know what I mean. So we are seeing ourselves in that particular position as to that we are these people and then there's the rest. We are so good because we have money and then there's the rest. And I think you have to sort of look at, you know, how I had a very interesting conversation a few weeks ago with Prashant Kidambi, who has written this fantastic book about the first All India team, which is from 1911. And in which it said that, remember, eventually cricket is a game of empire. So this was the conversation between Prashant, Mukul Keswan and myself. And this came up and they said, listen, at that time it was the British Empire and everyone sort of gravitated towards it. And now the empire is a financial empire. And India is the leader of that empire. So you have to see if you're leading the empire, particularly if it's a sport, what is the kind of influence or the role that you may want to have? Now, I have with me here, I'll just end my remarks here a little bit. I have with me the speech made by Anil Kumble, who at the M.A.K. Patawadi Memorial Lecture. And this is what he said. And I would like this to be reminded, but I feel this has been forgotten. This is what Kumble said. Traditionally, our leadership style has relied less on belligerence and more on driving consensus. It is important that the development of cricket and its popularity among its member nations are protected and nurtured. There has been a shift in the balance of power. It is extremely important that we wear our power lightly and make contributions that are worthy of emulation, because cricket has to be above every other consideration. And you have to ask yourself at this point in time whether cricket is above the every other consideration of Indian cricket and the people that run it, whether it's the governors of the sport, whether it's the most influential people that are there in it, whether they run it or whether something else is now running it, has taken over and taken charge. So these are my remarks for the moment. And now we can talk about whatever else. Maybe, Bikasta, you would like us to, you have a few questions or however else you would like to take this ahead.
Yeah.
Thank you, both the panelists, for this most intriguing, sessions. I think I will just let it free. Both of you can discuss whatever you want to discuss.
I'll just say a few things in response to Sharda's, fascinating remarks. First of all, I should say that something I've said elsewhere, which applies to Sharda per se. There is talk of a Godi media in politics, a section of the Indian media that cravenly supports, endorses, refuses to interrogate or scrutinize what the ruling party or government does. And there is also Godi media in cricket, which is spoon-fed by the BCCI. And Sharda is one of the few Indian journalists today who is not part of the Godi media. So I think it's very, very nice to have you here today. Open-minded, frank, intelligent, thoughtful, not adversarial simply for the sake of being adversarial, but critical and open-minded for the sake of throwing light, which is the job of any writer or journalist. Now, I'd just like to pick up on two points she made. One was about the Asian bloc that Jagmohan Dalmia sought to lead. You know, in the history of, and why we've abandoned that. In fact, we've become... although we have now abandoned collaboration with Bangladesh, Sri Lanka and Pakistan in favor of collaboration with England and Australia, in fact, we are leading England and Australia. You know, it's fair to say that we are Indian world cricket's sole superpower. And sole superpowerdom is bad in any sphere of human life. You know, having America as the sole superpower has been bad for global affairs. Several major powers are a check on one another in global politics, likewise in sporting administration. In the history of global cricketing administration, there have been three superpowers. It was England from 1877 to 1977, when they set the rules, they defined the schedule, they decided the laws, and they basically bullied the rest of the world. After 1977, when Kerry Packer came into the scene and Australia pushed back against England, Australia was the sole superpower through the 80s and 90s, where their media was incredibly jingoistic, where their supporters were seeking partisans, where we could not play our test matches at home in winter. We had to go there because that was their summer and every other country had to go there. And now we are the sole superpower. I think so that's something which is always bad. One big bully in a room is bad in every sphere of life, and cricket not excluded. So I'm glad Sharda brought that up. The other was her remark, taking off from what I said about communalism in cricket. And I just remind, she casually mentioned that India may never have, it's possible that India may never have a Christian, Sikh or Muslim captain again. And I'd like to reflect on the Christian, Muslim and Sikh captains of the past whom we had. You know, I hope she's wrong. I fear she's right, but I hope she's wrong. I hope she's wrong. And so does she. I think she also hopes that. But the first Christian captain we had was Vijay Samuel Hazare. Not many people know he was a Christian because he's known as Vijay Hazare. He led the first Indian team to win a test match in Chennai in January 1952. He was also with Lala Manak, one of the first commoners to captain an Indian team. Before that, you had to be a Maharaja, like Vizhi or Patowdi, or a wealthy man like Vijay Merchant. So he was an exemplary character. And he's one of the great heroes of me personally. And I had the extraordinary privilege of meeting him in his last days in Baroda. A great cricketer who got 100 against Miller, 100 in each innings against Miller and Lindwall in Australia. So well before Kohli and Gavaskar, he showed Indians how to play fast bowling overseas. Right. So he was the first Christian captain. The first Muslim captain in memory serves was Nawab Ali, Mansur Ali Khan Patowdi, who among whose great achievements were the first victory overseas in New Zealand in 1967. But his achievement was not just cricketing. He was the first Indian captain to overcome parochialism. Before Patowdi and after Patowdi, if the captain was from Bombay, there was a Bombay flavor to the team, and people spoke in Marathi. And Bombay wicketkeepers were likely to be chosen over Bengal wicketkeepers even if they were not enough. If the captain was of Delhi, there was Delhi parochialism. Then there was South Zone parochialism, where a captain from Karnataka would lobby for a guy from Tamil Nadu. So Pataudi's great achievement was that he was the first non-parochial Indian captain. And then you had Bishan Singh Bedi, who was the first Sikh captain. And whose great achievement? I mean, not only was he one of the truly great spin bowlers, not only is a person of great moral courage and integrity, he was the first Indian cricketer to fight for decent payment for cricketers. Without Bedi, you would have not had the IPL salaries you have now. Because when Bedi first played for India, Indian cricketers were paid 50 rupees per day for a test match. And there was a famous case where they won a test match in 4 days and got 200 rupees instead of 250 rupees. So Bedi led. I mean, he was a great trade unionist. I mean, he was a person who fought for equality and justice for cricket. And it was totally coincidental that Hazare is Christian, Pataudi is Muslim, and Bedi is Sikh. But here were these three characters from three different religions, none of whom were a Hindu, who exemplified the best in Indian cricket and in Indian social ethos. So I'd like to just, you know, take what Sharda said to refresh our memories about the history of these great captains.
I just wanted to say here that, like Ram, you know, I'm saying that, listen, maybe we are just being very downbeat today, whatever the factors are. I think the Wasim Jafar case particularly that happened was very disturbing. Because what we started hearing around us is that no, you know, this was the kind of thing that they were talking about when he was Mumbai captain. And I'm saying, you know, this boy has been captain. He is the son of a bus driver from BSC bus driver from Bombay. He has been Mumbai captain for 4 years. Mumbai is ruled by the Shiv Sena. So do you think this would have been possible? First of all. Second of all, when this Wasim Jafar issue came up, he was questioning administrators about selection fraud, which is, I mean, it is so widespread in India at the junior level, and Uttar Pradesh particularly is the most, Uttar Pradesh, Uttarakhand now, which has broken up, has got a separate statehood virtually, because selection fraud is a very rampant and a commonly known thing. So the moment he said this, the moment he questioned authority by saying your selection is wrong, they pulled out the card that is most popular in contemporary India. And I think for the first time in cricket has been experienced something of this sort, that he is doing this. The only other time that I remember it happening, I could be wrong, Ram, maybe there are instances in history that you're familiar with, is when Mohammad Azharuddin was charged with this whole match fixing thing. Yeah. And he said, no, this is happening to me because I'm a Muslim. And all of us were like banging our heads and saying, of all the things to say, you know. And that has been the most disturbing aspect of what has happened. The unraveling of cricket or India has been the fact that for the first time, no matter what the politicians are involved in cricket, for whatever reasons that they are, for the first time, it is a political ideology that is trying to marinate itself with the rest of the cricket that is there. You know, I mean, Ram was on the committee of administrators, and he can tell you lots of stories about administrative malfeasance. But this, to my mind, is the most disturbing development that's happening. And I mean, I know as cricket fans, we can often literally put our blinkers on and say, we don't care what's happening. We just want to watch a match and feel good. But let it be known that these are things that are playing themselves out in Indian cricket, and be worried about it, because there are great, you know, there are huge flaws in Indian cricket, but there is great joy and beauty in Indian cricket. And if it gets spoilt in this manner, to go back on it will be pretty impossible. That is my sort of general doomsday scenario of the moment.
No, you're right, Teshada. I mean, if you look at, we should teach Pakistan as a cautionary example, where one of their great cricketers had to change his religion to become captain.
Look at it.
A Christian had to become a Muslim so that you have a shot at captaincy. We should treat that as a cause. Do we want to go down that line?
Yeah. That's true. Yeah, that's what they're seeing. That's what they're seeing that's happening. And, you know, why does administration matter? I think administration matters because of the message that they are about to send out. And the message previously that was sent out, administration was, politicians are in, all cricket administrators will tell you, politicians are in this, we are happy they are in this. I mean, all of us as journalists will object and we'll say this is not right. And but he said, because politicians are able to cut through our red tape. if we want a ground, if we want to have relations with Pakistan in any way, to be able to play cricket, they'll say, never mind, we'll make sure that this can go through. They'll do those things. And it's almost in a way that the clubby sort of nature of cricket administration in India, political sort of, it was cross-party. I think cross-party, whether it's corruption or influence or whatever it was that they were seeking, it was cross-party. It wasn't the dominance of a party ideology, which I think is the most, you know, and you see it in social media as well. You see how everybody responds to things, cricketers respond to social media. Why are we talking about social media now? Because this is the first generation of cricketers that have come into their sport, onto fame and celebrity through social media. Previously, there was a very different equation that players had. They could just duck out of a political question and not have to answer. Now they have to answer. They're living their lives on social media. So there are all these things that are happening. And if we want to see what's happening in India, particularly Indian cricket, which, like Ram said, is the most popular pop cultural mass phenomenon that there is, you can see it through that. You can see how people are responding to questions about nation, for example, you know. Yeah, Bitasa, I think we are ready for questions.
Yes, we'll take a few questions. Okay. Whoever has a question can raise your hand and I will call out your name and you can unmute yourself and answer the question. Or you can type in your question in the chat box also. I'll read it out.
And I also think, Ram, before a question does come up, that Kumble's sort of words are what everyone who is in cricket should use.
Yeah,
you say that, you know, you're working for cricket. You're not working for anything else around it, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
And the whole stadium thing anyway is also like you said, yeah. And there was just unified silence, you know, around the fact that the stadium had been named. Like I said, the president had come all the way from Delhi to inaugurate the stadium.
Source.
The president is citizen number one, you know.
Yeah.
So I think I was inaugurating the stadium.
It was a story, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So you can see more, maybe for the first time or maybe not, I don't know what you think about it, Ram, that you're seeing what's happening in Indian social life being played out in cricket in that sense. I don't
yes.
know if you agree with that idea.
No, absolutely. I mean, it's not completely. I'll give you a small parallel and not very present parallel, which is in 76, must have been January or February 1976, I don't know how old you were, Sharda, then.
Under 10.
Under 10. Too young to have to remember. I was 17 and a half. And I was in my college quadrangle at 2 a.m. listening to the last stages of India's epic chase of 400 odd at Port of Spain against West Indies.
Wow.
And if memory serves, it's the only time in Indian cricket history that Gavaskar and Vishwanath both got hundreds. In the same innings, and we won the match. We beat the record then held by Bradman's team of the top fourth innings chase. And the commentator, whom I shall not name because his descendants may be here, went ballistic. You know, about such a great victory. He said, "Yeah, Mahatma Gandhi ka desh hai. Yeah, Bhagwan Buddha ka desh hai." Then he went on. ये इंदिरा गांधी का देश है
oh.
ये 20 सूत्री कार्यक्रम का देश है
oh.
20 पॉइंट प्रोग्राम ऑफ दैट
दिस टाइप ऑफ द कमेंटेटर्स हैवंट हर्ड अबाउट येट आई थिंक दिस लेवल वी हैव नॉट रीच्ड ओके सो आई एम अ लिटिल ऑप्टिमिस्टिक
सो दे आर सम पैरेलल्स सो एनीवे या आई थिंक विवेकानंद दबाड़े हैड अ क्वेश्चन
हाय प्रोफेसर रामचंद्र सो आई हैव अ क्विक क्वेश्चन So, I mean, do you see the Indian cricketers, again, going back to the time of Dravid or Kumble or Lakshman, when it was a real gentleman sport from now?
You know, I think people have to play hard. You know, Dravid wanted to win every match. He wasn't a sporting loser, right? Yeah. I mean, so I think that's... you know, people... So, I think, let's not think that they were gentlemen per se. I think... One of the reasons it's you're not likely to go back to that time is now, as Sharda said, politics is so important, social media is so important, you have to conform to the dominant ethos of the day, you can't be yourself. Also, Dravid, Lakshman, and Kumble all I think had college degrees before getting into cricket. I'm not sure about Lakshman, but probably he too. certainly came from now. And yeah, now at 16 or 17, you'd be headhunted by an IPL team. You'd be emotionally immature. You wouldn't know what to say. Suddenly, you'd become incredibly famous, and it's sort of a, you know, it all goes to your head. But Sharda, maybe better equipped to answer that question.
I think that, you know, again, like Ram is saying, gentleman is not exactly a sort of a fitting description, in the sense that they were competitive. All of them were very competitive. So is this generation of Indian cricketer. I think we mustn't forget that by and large, the Indian team is fairly unconfrontational. We saw that happening in this, as in unnecessarily confrontational in that sense. We saw that happening in the series victory in Australia. And there is a general ethos of decent conduct. You don't hear stories of them having drunken brawls or whatever. So it's not that they don't, they're not there. I think what the difference that you see is that is the IPL factor when it comes in, and their social media presence and how it plays itself out. You do see how does the market respond to this? Not very well, I'm afraid. The market is not the most, doesn't have the most imagination going, because all the ads will go to Kohli and Dhoni maybe, and a little bit Rohit Sharma, and then it's all shut down. I mean, I remember having a conversation with an ad person once and saying, listen, why can't you, if you believe that cricket is a great market play, I mean, it's a great sort of scope for advertisements and everything, why can't you talk about the skills, about how difficult it is? Why are our cricket players always selling colas and doing something stupid in an ad? Why aren't you showing us what their skill is? You know, you're able to see, why is it difficult to nail a Yorker? Tell us what that is. Don't just show us Jasprit Bumrah wearing a suit. You know, so that is the kind of sort of, it's almost an easy choice that is taken by the market. The Indian captain has always been the figurehead. And Kohli therefore stands for this India that is new India, and he's celebrating it and whatever. He's a remarkable, extraordinary cricketer. But not every Indian cricketer is cut off that cloth. You know, they all are following the fitness factor and all the rest of it, but not all of them are cut off that temperamental cloth as well. Like he's almost ready to explode at every second. But that just makes him who he is. So I think it's we should appreciate what we have at the moment. And there are some questions that have turned up. Bikasa, do you want to?
Oh, thank you.
Yeah, I'll just read them out. It's on the chat box. So one question is by Abhijit. He asks, what is the impact of technology in cricket?
I'll take that, Ram.
Sharda, you take that. Yeah.
Yeah. I think particularly with the development of bats, what you'll see, that is the big impact of technology. That's number one. Secondly, it's huge, because you'll see mishits going for six and so on. And to the complete disdain and horror of all of us older people. So Sanjay Manjrekar once did a video with showing the bat that he used and the bat that is used currently. So that has taken a lot of the bowler sort of chance in the game. The bats have sort of taken it away, number one. Number two, data technology is used a lot, which you'll see a lot more that's played out in 2020 cricket. You'll see it in the IPL. Then it'll transfer into test cricket maybe, when they're thinking of doing matchups and so on. But even more than just than technology, you have to think, is why are grounds so small now? Why does everyone take the boundaries in just so that everything is a six? You know, so that way you have done more damage to bowlers, I feel, than even the bats. You've taken out the catches in the deep for the spinners. It's gone because the ground is so tiny, you know. So those are the things that I think maybe there should be a little bit more noise about. And there should be a little bit more sort of protest about, to say that, listen, everything doesn't have to be a small ground, you know.
I just say one thing about technology, and that is television. You know, I think one of the things that satellite television did was to show viewers all over India what technique was, how you played a cover drive, how you bowled the outswing, how you used the crease, how you fielded that slip. You know, I come from a generation which only heard it on the radio, So we didn't really know how the game was played at the highest level. I think television is one of the reasons you have cricketers from everywhere, is that from very early age, they see, you know, Ashwin using the crease, or the way Kohli plays the inside out cover drive, and they start playing it at an early age as well. You know, so I think that bit, and of course, television technology has now helped in umpiring a great deal. And I'm a great fan of the review system, you know, in that sense. I mean, we can debate about umpire's call and so on. But I think it's to the advantage of bowlers that way. I mean, it's kind of leveled it out, Sharda. If bats have gone in favor of the batsman, you know, DRS has gone in favor of the bowlers. So, you know, in some ways...
Perhaps. I'm a little biased towards bowlers, and I think they should be allowed to bowl as many bouncers as they want. But that's just my thing. But what you're saying is right, yeah.
Okay, we'll take the next question. Could you please comment on conflict of interest and whether there's hope for improved corporate governance for the game?
No hope. Reforming Indian cricket is a lost cause. I mean, as someone who was in the hot seat, I can tell you that it's a lost cause. It is shocking what goes on. You know, and I'd say this bluntly, the committee of administrators headed by Mr. Vinod Rai was supposed to clean up Indian cricket. It inherited Indian cricket from N. Srinivasan and it handed it over to N. Srinivasan and Amit Shah. You know, that's what happened, right? So it is, I mean, it's the most corrupt and cronyist board possible. It's the board for corruption and cronyism in India. That's what the BCCI is. And as someone recently told me, by the way, Sharda, I got a letter from a fan in New Zealand who had read my recent book, which you also graciously reviewed in the Telegraph. And he said about my chapters on cricket administration, he said it used to be said about Brazil in the 60s. God has blessed them with the best footballers and the most useless administrators. So I think that's what God has done to us today.
I have nothing to say on that. Rather than everything.
The next question by Vikram Rao. Thank you to both the panelists for their wonderful perspectives on the topic. On the mention about caste and communalism aspects, maybe this do exist in pockets, but overall the sport of cricket has been a leveler for providing a lot of small town players the opportunity to make it into the national team based on merit. Cricketer Natarajan and his journey being a recent aspect. Maybe we should talk about this positive also.
Yeah, so I think cricketers themselves are non-communal. You know, so when an Indian team has, I mean, and Dravid talks about this very nicely in his Bradman lecture, right? It's the spectators and the fans whose minds are communalized. Also, interestingly, when India plays Pakistan, you know, the players are great friends. I mean, so that's not an issue, but it's really the partition of the mind of the spectator. But caste is an issue. You know, it is a fact that after Palwankar Balu and his brothers, very few Dalits have played for India. I mean, and I think no Adivasi, virtually no one from the Northeast. I'll just
step in here, Ram, if I can.
Yeah, please.
You know, what you find particularly in cricket is the question, if it's asked, people are absolutely stunned. They don't know how to respond to it. They start talking about meritocracy. What has happened in India, particularly with reference to scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, is that they have veered into other sports where, you know, you find them in hockey, you find them in boxing, you find them in other sports where it's not an issue. And the whole issue is not whether there is bias. The whole issue is there access at all? I read a very interesting report again in the Indian Express, which talked about a Dalit Premier League taking place in Gujarat. I cannot for the life of me find any information about it anywhere else because I want to know who are these players, why did they go and have this thing and what happened about it. There has to be, you know, there's not even very much work that is done into it. And it's almost like it's almost like people don't want to talk about it, you know. Vikram, it's not that we don't want to talk about positive things. We'd love to talk about positive things. I mean, there are such lovely stories about Munaf Patel going over to, Ishan Sharma going to Munaf Patel and said, Munna bhai, can I please sleep? When he was a young under 19, when he was a 19-year-old in Australia, said, Munna bhai, can I please sleep in your room? I'm scared of sleeping by myself. He came from a house in Delhi, which had lots of people and everything. And all. He could not bear living in a 5-star hotel room. So he slept in Munaf Patel's room on the floor. Mohammed Kaif will tell you that he heard somebody doing, Hanuman Chalisa and someone else's prayer. So prayer and faith are all part of Indian cricket. They are all very much part of the cricketer's life. The cricketers are very religious and superstitious people. Like Ram Singh, they are not communal. What is happening around them is. how long is it going to stop from them getting brainwashed by it? We don't know. I know it's sounding like I'm very sort of negative or whatever, but India is going through a lot of churn and we have to be aware that it is happening.
So we haven't really talked about women's cricket so far, and maybe Sharda would want to say some things, but one of the things I'd like to say where I think some of our past cricketers not conducted themselves well on social media is a case from about 3 or 4 years ago when two of our top cricketers savaged an independent-minded young woman who wanted peace between India and Pakistan.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Which is awful. That treatment was awful. I think I think masculinity, patriarchy, and I'd say Kohli has been a good example. Contrary to what might one think, when Kohli took time off to be with his wife during the birth of their first child, he was widely mocked and criticized, but I saluted him. Because, it's not only the mother who has to bring up and look after the child. I mean, parenting is a joint thing. And I think that display, in the case of that independent-minded young woman who wanted peace between India and Pakistan, the daughter herself of a martyred soldier, and the way in which our top cricketers went after her, some of our on social media, I think maybe Sharda would want to say a little bit about sexism in cricket. And,
The crazy thing about women's cricket is the fact that the Indian women's team, when compared to other sports, and I've been saying this a lot, when compared to other sports, is treated worse. Because the Indian women's hockey team has played enough in the last year. The Indian women boxers have traveled, trained, competed. Wrestlers, the same thing. Badminton players, the same thing. Shooters, the same thing. The Indian women's team, the team from the biggest, strongest, wealthiest superpower of sport, is treated like they are second-class citizens and they don't matter, and they'll throw them some 3-4 IPL matches. So you're looking at a very, it's not even a latent sexism, it's just obvious, it's just there. They can't be bothered, that is what has happened. And the point of sort of being positive about it, of course we are positive about Indian cricket. There are lots of things to be positive about. But if you don't point these things out, Vikram, what is caste, what is sexism, what is communalism, it will be seen as okay. It will be seen as it's fine. Chalta hai, it can't be chalta hai. At least from our eyes, as the eyes of the fans, it should not be seen as chalta hai.
We'll move on to the next question. It's by Arun Balaraman. Is the power equation going to change in a few years? Will India continue to remain dominant? The game is changing. England is experimenting with the 100. The game is moving to the US.
So maybe I'll take this first and let Sharda then, my sense is that, things are massively loaded in India's favor because we're 1 billion+ people. We have 30 or 35 first-class teams. Our population is crazy about cricket. There is no competition. All our emotional, psychological, financial, social investment is in making Indian cricket win all the time. Soon we have to play in the World Test Championship against New Zealand, a country of 5 million people, half the population of Bangalore. And it's extraordinary they made it there. In New Zealand, cricket is probably the third sport, Sharda, after
rugby.
After rugby and soccer?
Not soccer. It's sort of first and a half almost. Second and a half.
Okay.
If you're looking at women's netball or something.
Yeah. So actually, given how populous we are, how much money is spent on cricket, how much investment goes into cricket, emotional and financial and cultural, we should be winning all the time. It's a mystery that we don't win every match.
Yeah. Arun, I'll just tell you one thing. I remember I met a cricket official in Australia, at the time, and he said, all of us think that if India gets it right, if India gets its organization right, we're all dead. And this was in 2013. And he was laughing about it, and he said that. And you would have to say, you want to tell him now the organization is never going to be right. Certainly, you'll have a chance.
I don't think the US or China would take to it, Arun. And there have been these stories before. Jagmohan Dalmia was going to take it to China and make it an Olympic sport. It is not going to happen, And I think
They don't even want to play in the Olympics, which is ridiculous. If you play 2020 in the Olympics, like India's are so resistant. BCCI is so resistant to playing cricket in a larger mega event.
I think they should put things in perspective. I mean, we shouldn't. I think you know, it's in my view, we glorify cricketers too much. You know, I think the greatest Indians are our classical musicians. It's much harder to be a classical musician than to be a cricketer. You know, so I think fine, but you know, I think there's a problem with our winning so much. We think that, and it also might, like Brazil in the 60s, our winning in cricket repeatedly might excuse for all our failures in other spheres of life, and I worry about it. So actually, I don't want India to win in cricket all the time, because then we pay attention to the other problems in our society.
Samshar Chaudhary, you can unmute yourself and ask the question. Okay, maybe I'll ask the next question. It's by Arpan Gupta. Hi, I have a question to Ram sir. Sir, do you think because of the interruption in cricket, like break after each over, each session, the advertisement took a huge role in bringing money into Indian cricket? Okay. And if that, then do you think this money has become the control of Indian cricket? And that started reflecting the dark side of cricket, as you said, regarding Modi Stadium and Ambani End.
So, yeah, that's a very good question. I think it's a required detailed reflection answer. You're right. I mean, it was nice that television brought the game everywhere, but then you had ads, and then you monetize the ads. And the more important the game, the more you paid for the ad. And then, of course, that dictated, as Sharda said, you know, all the ads went to one or two, all the commercials went to one or two players and not to the whole team, and usually to the batsmen and never to the bowlers and so on. And then did the sponsors start dictating how the game would be scheduled? And forget the Ambani and the Adani aspect of it. One of my saddest moments in the BCCI was when a journalist informed me that during the 2017 IPL in March, the IPL coincided with the 100th birth anniversary of India's greatest ever cricketer. And India's greatest ever cricketer, not Virat Kohli, not MS Dhoni, not Sachin Tendulkar, not Kapil Dev, but the great all-rounder Vinu Makkad. And, 12th March was his centenary. And I put a proposal to the board. I said, dedicate a match to him. Call it the Vinu Makkad match. You know, our greatest ever cricketer. But and he would have gone for a huge, just imagine what Vinu Makkad, batsman, bowler, fielder, what kind of fee he would have commanded. Hey, premier to call the IPL. But they were so scared of offending the sponsors that they did not do that. And in fact, the Narendra Modi Stadium should be called the Vinu Makkad Stadium, because he was a great son of Gujarat, by the way, right? So I think in this sense, I think the sponsorship has, a sense of history. I mean, it's amazing that we don't have a cricket museum, that the board does not have a good cricket museum for our most, for our favorite popular sport. So I think, but I think Sharda may have more to say on this.
I think television, what Ram is saying is right. I mean, I believe when the conversation was had with the franchises, they were okay with the match for Vinu Makkad. You know, I believe that the franchises were all right with it. I mean, I could be wrong, I'm not sure. But what he said is that I agree that television has been a double-edged sword in that sense. It has also expanded the game and taken it everywhere else, and it's also made so many rules and about it that you can't even have a frank conversation about cricket on the commentators cannot say what they feel. You know, so is that the kind of commentary we want? No, we want open and frank and all that kind of commentary. Hindi commentary might sometimes be a little bit more open than you say. I don't speak any other language other than Hindi and Marathi, so I don't really understand what kind of conversations are going on there. But that's what fans need to have, a almost objective assessment of what's happening. But you don't get it in English commentary. So it's all because the commentators are now owned by the BCCI and the board. So they understand what TV does, but at the same time, they use TV to control. So.
Did Samshir Chaudhary, his hand is still up?
Yeah, his hand is still up. Would you like to go? Samshir Chaudhary, would you like to ask a question? Okay, I think I'll read the next question. It's by Amog Vaswaraj, for both. Do you see a silver lining in some of the wonderful individual stories, the likes of Mohammad Siraj and T. Natarajan coming into the sport?
Absolutely. There have always been stories like this. And the fact that they are there, they're wonderful stories. And but we mustn't use those stories to forget talking about other things that are not that good, you know. That's what I think.
Moving on to the next question by Vedant Sharma. Does cricket rise in, as the prime sport of India affected other sports like badminton and kabaddi in a big as a big tree soaking up water and drying up smaller shrubs? We can also see other sports trying to emulate IPL like kabaddi and badminton league.
Can I take that, Ram?
Please.
I don't think cricket is responsible for other sports they've taken up all the sponsorship. People in those sports don't work hard enough to market their sports and to sell it. And I have the theory about sports administrators is that they really don't want to create big stars in their sport because they become bigger than them. And that is what you see in a lot of sports. The Kabaddi League, it has not happened now because of COVID. The Kabaddi League was the most original and the most groundbreaking thing that happened thanks to television. That they created stars out of it. If your administration works in that direction, then all of you will get part of the pie. You know, there are sponsors that can't pay billions and millions of dollars. The Indian market is wide and broad, and there is money available. But you have to work hard to work for your sport, which a lot of the smaller sports federations don't do. So I think it's not fair in that sense to heap all the blame on cricket.
Samshir Chaudhary, would you like to ask a question if you're around?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me?
Please, we can hear you. Please go ahead.
First of all, my name is Samar Chaudhary. I mistyped it because of fudgy fingers.
Okay.
I want to float the idea of Hall of Fame as it exists in the United States for a variety of sports. What it does is it gives people of different time periods of a game representation of who's been the best at that particular time. And it's, I think everybody needs to, in India, go to a shrine of who's the best and when was this happening, what was his particular style. I mean, you can really go, for example, to ice hockey in Toronto, to the Hall of Fame and hear about Wayne Gretzky and what was so special about him. So I think India is the place. It's not Britain anymore or Australia or any of that. It's got to be India because India is where cricket is now. It would have been nice to have Pakistan, but I think we have a great divide on almost all things from language down to, but they play such great cricket. We all know that. So I would like to get other people's idea and your idea, both of you, on a Hall of Fame.
No, I think that's a very good suggestion, Mr. Chaudhary. I talked about the fact that we have no museum. So a great museum, which one section is Hall of Fame, but the other sections are the history of the sport, its spread, looking at posters, pictures, newspaper reports, memorabilia, but I think given how politicized Indian cricket administration is, this museum will have to be funded by a broad-minded philanthropist with no connection to any political party or the BCCI. Otherwise, you'll have all kinds of pressures, iska naam dal do, isko pehle dalo, isko mat dalo. Never have Bishan Singh Bedi because he's too frank in your Hall of Fame. So, for example, it's a great idea. But some cricket mad philanthropist should come forward with the money and create a great museum with a section of the Hall of Fame. CCI could do it in Bombay, and which is an independent organization, and have an annual lecture, which again, independent. It's not as if what will happen is the worry is if you have a Hall of Fame in India today, it will be orchestrated by the board and the Prime Minister will inaugurate it. Right. So you have to steer clear of all of that. I think you have to have a body of historical experts who will decide objectively what the museum should contain, who should be your first inductee in the Hall of Fame. I mean, in Newport, you have a tennis Hall of Fame, which is also a wonderful thing, like your ice hockey Hall of Fame. And you're absolutely right. Cricket Hall of Fame should be in India, not in Lords. I mean, we are the home of cricket absolutely. Now. You know, so you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. And ideally, it should be Mumbai because, and I concede to Sharda, it should not be Bangalore. It can be. You know, that's where our cricket was born, and that's where our first cricketers came. And maybe the CCI could, you know, a small portion of the CCI could be a museum and a Hall of Fame.
The ICC has its own sort of Hall of Fame thing that it does, you know, and again, I mean, we are in complete agreement with you. There are private fans who have their own little museums around the country. They've collected shirts, they've collected autographed bags, yes. They've collected photographs. It's all there. The BCCI even used to have, I don't know whether it's there now, a museum committee. This museum committee, I think, I remember 10 years at least, I've had a museum committee. Where the museum is, what happens, we don't know, but it's there.
Charda, with our inherent ability to create murtis, which yes. we do so well, it can have a 3D view and become hologram. Better than Madame Tussauds.
Hologram sort of images.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yes. Okay, thank you.
Most welcome.
I'm going to the next question. I'm skipping Amok's question since he has already asked one because, you know, for the time constraint. This is by Sarthak Talukdar. Football in India has not reached the nearest place at where cricket is. What is the basic cause of this and does it need more support from government side?
I'm answering. Football's basic cause is bad administration of the way football is run in the country. There is no encouragement given to having enough games for our young players to play, games, tournaments. It's the biggest lapse. Just turn to the sport. Instead of football, make it volleyball, make it rowing, make it, the answer is all the same. There are not enough pathways, there are not enough competition structures, which cricket, by the way, has. BCCI hosts, on a good year, minus COVID, 2,000 cricket matches every year. And they're very proud of how they do it. And they have a reason to be. No other sporting body has this kind of, even an attention paid to the kind of layers of competition that they are. So football is also, I'm a big fan of Indian football. Recent fan, sort of Arivste, I don't know if that's the correct word. But you can see the fact that there is football everywhere. There is football in parts of the country where you don't imagine that there will be, but it is. And what they're trying to do with the ISL is like a top-down approach, whereas you actually need something that's happening more at the grassroots and more widespread. So that kids who want to play football can play enough events, enough weekend leagues, enough school competitions from the age, starting from the age of 5 or 6.
I'll go to the next question. This is by Kavita Sarvepalli, the one whose hand is raised. I'll come to you in a while. Kavita asked that for both panelists, what do you think about World Test Championship, and do you concur with Kohli's comment that it is just a distraction from a serious test playing nations like ours?
I think the World Test Championship is a great idea. I think Kohli may have he may not agree with it, say 3 months from now, with the statement that he's made. He may have changed his mind. So I would just say that it's great that there's a World Test Championship. Everyone has been trying to have it. We at least want to see what it looks like. When it happens, does it work? Do we like it? Is the interest, and it's important for India particularly to have an investment in test cricket and to care about it. Because if India doesn't care about it, it's in serious trouble.
Abhiram, can you unmute yourself and ask your question? Yes, please go ahead and ask your question. Yeah.
So mine is kind of a follow-up to the answer to Vedant Sathak's question. You said that the main thing is the lack of administration and how people aren't taking the other sports as seriously as they have cricket. So I would like to ask if there is any role in this in about how cricket was introduced to the country. As far as I understand it, the reason that cricket has such a big role in our country right now is because when India was growing as a nation, you know, from the colonial period, it was first introduced by them, and I've heard many stories of where, you know, played a huge role in our in the struggle and the movement, and how cricket became a serious part over there. And most of the sentiment that was developed for cricket was developed during that time. So India, like cricket, developed in India because of the history it has with the country, and these other sports don't really have that sort of history. So is there any alternative that can make, you know, bring it up to momentum with cricket, any other sport, if it doesn't have this kind of history?
So I think, you know, my response to that would be all team sports were invented in the West. You know, football, hockey, rugby, athletics, swimming were invented in England. Basketball in America. So all sports came to India at the same time. And as I explained in the early part of my presentation, we took to cricket in a certain way, more than to the other sports. Today, it's not the history. I think it's the nationalism that's important. We are good at cricket, we're not good at football, so we'd rather follow cricket. You know, Sharda talked about the World Test Championship. If we win against New Zealand in whatever June or July, everyone will be in favor of it. If we lose, you know, who knows what people will say. But I think it is an important question. You know, why is it that we don't valorize success in other sports to the same extent? I mean, I'll just give you one example. The highest honor, a civilian honor in India, the Bharat Ratna. You will recall there was a Sachin Tendulkar got the Bharat Ratna. Before he got the Bharat Ratna, there was a debate. There was a widespread demand for him to get the Bharat Ratna, and there was a debate. Should sportsmen be given the Bharat Ratna? Right. And one of the most sensible interventions in that debate was by Suresh Menon, the sports writer, who said, you know, perhaps the Bharat Ratna should only be given to writers and musicians and scientists and philosophers and social workers. But if there is a case for it to be given to sports people, not just Tendulkar, but Vishwanathan Anand should have got it at the same time. I mean, he was a world champion in a world sport, not in a sport played by 8 countries. But of course, there were no supporters, no lobby for Vishwanathan Anand. But that shocking act of bias and prejudice, either give it to no sports person at all, and I'd be for that. But if you have to give it to a sports person, how can you deny it to Vishy Anand and give it to Tendulkar? I mean, it flies totally in the face of logic. It's an example of official political support for our social bias in favor of cricket. I mean, that was the moment in which, if you had given Vishy Anand the Bharat Ratna along with Sachin Tendulkar, the signal it would have sent to people who excel in other sports would have been astonishing.
I just want to ask, put in one sort of word here. The question was asked by whom? I'm seeing Vedant's name up. Who asked the question? Was it you, Vedant, or was it someone else?
It was me, Abhiram.
Abhiram. Hi. Sorry. You know, I don't know whether you know that in the 1960s, India was amongst the top footballing nations of Asia. We won a gold medal at the Asian Games. We made 2-3 rounds of we were close to semifinals of the Football World Cup. So it's not that we've not had a history of good sports performance. And hockey, of course, you know how many medals we won. We've had a history of maladministration, which you can see it as a pattern. The 1950s and 60s Olympic sport was supported by the government. No Olympic sport in India would have survived if the government would not have supported it. It was of a good standard. We had a good standard of team and players. India beat France, you know. So, to say that cricket is responsible for all these is not accurate at all. I think it is just lapses in administration and administrative foresight. When sport became professional, we put our feet up and said, hello, now it's too tough to do any work on it or forget about it. That's what has happened. That is my humble suggestion.
I'll quickly read the next question. And Vedant, yours would be the last question for the day. This is by Sunil Kumar. He asks, what is your comment on the reaction of Indian cricketers on internal matters? Debate on Twitter over farmers' protest, especially on the series of tweets from cricketers, including Sachin Tendulkar.
To Ram, this question is not
so. Do have a look at a piece I wrote in NDTV on it some months ago. I think it was disgraceful, and it showed a craven lack of spine. But I wasn't surprised by the craven lack of spine by our cricketing superstars, and particularly the craven lack of spine of Sachin Tendulkar in this regard. But I wrote a piece in NDTV on that matter.
Vedant Sharma, you please unmute yourself and ask the question.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. So, like, I am giving a follow-up to my question about that cricket as a victory showing up like all other sports. So, like, it was in the context of a aspiring sportsman. So, like, there are many qualities and like a sportsman should have, like a good athletic stamina, hand-eye coordination, etc. So, like, it's generally seen sportsman is good in like one or two sports in his like earlier years. Like we heard the anecdote of Dhoni being good in football, like first and cricket. So like, do you think that the allure and glamour of cricket like attracts more people than like other sports? That was my like initial context.
Yeah, I would say it certainly does. The allure and glamour of cricket does attract everyone to cricket more. So they tend not to play other sports. But also remember, when you're talking about what opportunities do they have to play and how does sport look like as a profession for them, as a livelihood for those people. So it's literally like they put all their investment into cricket because the rewards are enormous at the other end of it if you're successful. Similarly, in a lot of other parts of the country, people go into other sports that they see that, okay, there are job opportunities available, there is a chance to make a career out of it. Cricket is bigger because it's a bigger sport, and again, there would be, say, 5,500 cricketers of all ages, men, women in the country. There would not be that many football players or hockey players in the country. Because cricket gives you those opportunities. So you have to create opportunities for people to want to play.
I think with this, we can call it a day today.
Thank you
to the panelists for this most engaging session. It's people with so many facets of the country, just looking at the sport of the game of cricket itself. Thank you so much, and we hope to have this kind of sessions more.
Thank you, Vidasta. Thank you, Sharda.
Thank you,
Ram. Everyone who attended.
Bye. Thanks a lot to everyone. Thank you. Bye.
Bye.